Have you ever been chugging down a protein shake before an intense workout session and wondered, does this thing actually help or am I just guzzling down money that I could be spending on protein-rich meals instead? Then worry no more because we've got the answers. They just may not be what you think. Oh, and be sure to stick around for the end. We'll walk you through exactly how much and when to consume your protein for optimal results. Whether it works or not, protein supplements are big business. The sports supplement industry rakes in over $27 billion every year, and rising. While we'd love to say the supplement industry only cares about your health and puts your health over profit, we can't. At the end of the day, the supplement industry is like any other industry whose primary job is to make money, so we just can't take those companies at their word on the effectiveness of their products. While some health and workout supplements veer on the side of snake oil, it's not quite the same with protein powder. Why? Because at its core, protein powder is just processed food. So why take it other than real food when you're looking to build mass fast? During the refining process that turns raw food into protein powder, protein is extracted from real food sources and is then broken down further into a fine powder. What this does is it breaks down the protein, or pre-digests it if you will, meaning you're able to absorb and utilize the amino acids it contains much faster. Now, under normal circumstances, you don't really need a fast supply of amino acids. Just eat some steak and the amino acids will gradually be released. Using protein powder during your daily routine offers no real benefits other than being cheap and convenient, which is still a plus. However, there is one period in the day of particular interest. That's right, it's the post-workout. Whether you're playing sports, hitting the weights, or just working on your cardio, anything that causes minor muscle damage, typically tied to healthy exercise. After these moments, your body is thrown into a highly anabolic state by a dramatic rise in muscle protein synthesis. This is the process that repairs muscle. In this state, your body craves more amino acids to rebuild. It's like a bunch of construction workers all hyped up on Red Bull and ready to work. The only thing they need is bricks to build, and those bricks are amino acids. Now, you don't have to eat protein powder, as your body will have pools of amino acids it can pull from. These are the leftovers from previous meals that are just waiting to be used. In addition, you could even just eat whole foods to provide protein. However, as mentioned, this must be digested before the muscles can access the amino acids. And it's here we find why we specifically take protein powder after training. Taking a protein powder that is already processed and broken down floods your bloodstream with amino acids. At the same time, it also causes an increase in muscle protein synthesis. It's a cheap and convenient method that makes it incredibly easy to create an optimum environment for building muscle. So, how does this work? Well, that's what we want to find out. One of the main reasons lifters take protein powder is for muscle growth. So, does protein powder actually drive more gains? Spoiler alert, yes, it does. A meta-analysis from 2012 examined studies with over 600 participants to determine if protein supplementation increased muscle mass. To be clear, this study specifically looked at the intake of protein powder post-workout. In addition, it only examined studies that were at least 6 weeks long, as it's believed protein supplementation benefits come from long-term use. You can't just chug protein shakes once and be summer body ready. After a full analysis, they made a pretty big find. When compared to placebos, protein supplementation resulted in a 38% greater increase in fat-free mass. So, if you gained 10 pounds of muscle without protein supplementation, you could have gained an extra 3.6 pounds with it. Right here, it's important to note that, as you can see, you can still increase muscle mass without protein supplementation. However, it will just capitalize on the hard work you put in the gym. So why settle for 10 pounds when you could have 13.8 just by drinking a tasty, cheap shake? Sounds like a no-brainer to us. A more recent meta-analysis was then performed in 2017, which examined a total of 1,863 participants. This makes it one of the largest meta-analyses to date. Almost as large as you'll be if you keep chasing those gains. Again, when comparing protein supplementation with resistance training alone, the supplementation produced better results. This included a 27% increase in fat-free mass, as well as a 14% increase in muscle fiber cross-section area when compared to the placebo. One interesting note made in this meta-analysis was that protein supplementation was more effective for resistance-trained individuals. Why could this be the case? We suspect it's because it's easier for non-trained individuals to build muscle. When an untrained person starts training, gaining muscle is relatively easy. There's a lot more wiggle room with diet and training to see positive results in muscle growth. However, as you become more advanced, putting on muscle becomes increasingly difficult. We want to note this doesn't mean that untrained individuals did not see increases in muscle mass. They do. What that means is they saw similar results whether they consumed a protein supplement or not. Now that's two huge meta-analyses that both confirm that protein powder supplementation results in an increase in muscle mass. This is the general consensus since studies began on protein supplementation. For example, this study way back from 2005. In it, 22 young healthy men partook in resistance training methods for 14 weeks. When examining all the variables, everything was similar. One real difference was their post-workout meal. The control group simply ate a serving of carbohydrates, while the experimental group consumed a supplement containing 25 grams of protein, 16.6 grams from whey, and the remaining from other sources. After 14 weeks, the protein group did see a small advantage in strength with the squat jump. In the squat jump, an athlete descends into a semi-squat position and holds the position for approximately 3 seconds before takeoff. Here, the protein group saw a 9% improvement in height, whereas the carb group saw none. However, in the counter-movement vertical jump, there was no difference as both groups saw an increase of 10%. The counter-movement vertical jump is performed when the athlete starts from a standing position and initiates a downward movement, which is immediately followed by an upward movement leading to takeoff. Now, in terms of muscle hypertrophy, the protein group really outshined the carbohydrate group and saw significantly greater growth. Specifically, the protein group saw an 18% greater increase in type 1 fibers. These are smaller fibers that have less force capability, yet possess awesome endurance capability. In addition, they saw a 26% increase in the cross-section area of the muscle. 26%! The growth in the carb group was just negligible. Now let's go back to the increase in squat jumps. What's going on here? Why would the protein supplementation group see a larger squat jump than the placebo? Well, one of the reasons for the increase in the squat jump was thought to have occurred due to the increase in type 2 muscle fibers. Remember, these are the fibers that are responsible for creating a high amount of force. To look at the association between strength gains and muscle gains more, let's revisit the 2012 meta-analysis from earlier in the video. Remember, it reviewed 22 trials with protein's effect on muscle mass. However, it also examined gains in strength and concluded that the protein supplementation does in fact contribute to gains in strength, specifically 1 rep max strength or the maximum amount of weight you can lift at one time. Now let's dig into the muscle hypertrophy results a little deeper. The results specifically showed a 45% larger increase in type 1 muscle fibers and a 55% larger increase in type 2 fibers. This increase was then related to the increase in strength, where it was found that a greater increase in muscle fiber CSA was accompanied by a 20% greater increase in 1 rep max leg press strength. Basically, the muscles with a larger increase in type 2 muscle fibers saw greater improvements in strength. To briefly explain this, an increase in muscle size and muscle strength are related but can occur from completely different mechanisms. Strength occurs through the improvement of the neuromuscular system, while the increased muscle mass occurs through the addition of contractile units of the muscle. This means that strength can increase independently from muscle growth. The existing muscle learns to produce more force. At the same time, when a muscle grows, it adds contractile units, which means the potential for strength goes up as well. So strength can go up through improvements in the neuromuscular system as well as the addition of contractile units. Therefore, strength and size will grow together, but it's not always a one-to-one increase. However, the muscle growth that occurred from the protein supplementation in the study also enabled the muscle to create more strength than if no muscle growth had occurred. Lucky for us, we can also turn to the other, more recent meta-analysis for more evidence of the effect of protein supplementation on strength. The studies in this meta-analysis utilized a variety of 1 rep max testing, such as bench press, arm curl, squat, and lat pulldown. Together, participants saw an average of a 9% increase in 1 rep max strength. However, as noted in the study, a 9% increase is pretty cool, but it's not a magic bullet. Your programming and exercise selection will likely have a much greater effect on strength gains. At that same time, we'll take the 9% increase if all we need to do is drink a thick, delicious ice cream cake batter protein shake. But perhaps the clearest illustration of protein supplementation benefiting an athlete is with pre-sleep protein. Pre-sleep protein is a relatively new area of study that examines the usefulness of drinking a protein supplement 30 minutes before sleep. Usually, this is done with casein protein, a slow-digesting protein. Unlike whey, which floods the bloodstream with amino acids quickly, casein releases a slower, steadier stream of amino acids. As a result, when taken before sleep, it increases the amount of amino acids in the bloodstream all night as you sleep, as well as muscle protein synthesis. This is effective at increasing muscle growth. While there's still a lot to learn about nighttime protein, the studies we have as of now are very promising. A meta-analysis from 2020 looked at all the studies to date and analyzed the results that a pre-sleep protein supplement had on muscle protein synthesis and other outcomes. It found that a 20 to 40 gram serving of casein protein increases muscle protein synthesis overnight. With that said, the general recommendation is on the larger end of that spectrum, 30 to 40 grams. That's great, but does this transfer to actual muscle growth? Well, pre-sleep protein was found to have positive benefits on one rep max strength, muscle size, and an increase in the cross-sectional area of muscle fibers. What makes this benefit specific to protein powder is that protein powder allows you to eat a large amount of protein quickly and with low calories. To reach that same amount of protein and calories with whole food, you need to eat two whole skinless chicken breasts with no seasoning or sauce. Yummy! Give me the cookies and cream protein shake, please. To our knowledge, there's been no study that's looked at whole food pre-sleep, but we imagine it's just not practical to do it on a consistent basis. And this is really the main benefit of protein powder. At certain times, having a quick, convenient protein source that actually tastes good is a very nice tool to have. In fact, this was the consensus of one of, if not the only study we know of, that looked at using strictly whole foods for protein intake, including post-exercise. Yes, you can definitely only eat whole foods, however, it is difficult. The research concluded, however, obtaining dietary protein exclusively from whole foods may not always be convenient or feasible due to a variety of reasons including cost, palatability, competitive or training schedule, and volume of whole food that needs to be consumed to meet protein requirement. Protein supplements remain a convenient complementary nutritional strategy for physically active adults to meet protein recommendations at select meals throughout the day. And that should be your main takeaway. Protein powder is a cheap, convenient protein source that can be strategically used to optimize training outcomes and muscle growth. Taken at any other time of day, protein powder is really just another food source that makes reaching protein intake easy. So yes, protein powder works because it is just that, protein. So we've clearly shown that protein powder offers benefits, but what does that mean for you? Well, for one, it's important to point out that the meta-analysis specifically mentioned prolonged use. While there are some measurable outcomes that can occur overnight, meaningful adaptations take a long period of consistent use. Therefore, your nutritional strategy for protein should become a constant. In addition, consider your daily protein intake rather than just a single serving. The daily protein intake for athletes and lifters is much more than the general population's recommended daily intake due to the increased stress and damage placed on the muscle. Therefore, the general recommendation by leading sports researchers, such as the ISSN, is anywhere from 1.6 to 2 grams per kilogram of body weight. If you're in a caloric surplus, you can get away with the lower end. If you're losing weight with a caloric deficit, stick to the higher end. Not that you would, but you can probably guess this shouldn't all be eaten in one sitting. Studies have shown that spreading your protein throughout the day can optimize protein's role in the support and maintenance of your muscle mass. This is likely due to the spreading out of the spike in muscle protein synthesis from a single meal that lasts anywhere from 3 to 5 hours. Therefore, spread your total protein intake across 4 to 6 servings throughout the day every 3 to 4 hours. The only thing to keep in mind here is that each serving should contain a minimum of 20 to 25 grams of protein. This tends to be the threshold for maximum spikes in MPS. What that means is that you can definitely consume more than this and will probably have to eat your total daily intake. However, that spike in muscle protein synthesis will not be as dramatic as it is up to the 25 grams when it starts to level off. Other than that, there are two occasions which merit special attention. First is your post-workout feeding. It used to be taught that you had 60 minutes post-workout to consume a meal. This was to capitalize on the spike of muscle protein synthesis from working out. We now know it isn't exactly true. As mentioned, the spike in MPS lasts much longer than 60 minutes. However, it does start to slowly decline. As long as you eat every 3 to 4 hours, you don't need to worry about it. However, we still advise to eat protein sooner rather than later, just like in the studies. At the same time, you might want to eat a larger amount of protein at this time. Before, we said that each serving should be at least 20 grams, as this is the threshold for maximal increases in MPS. However, after training, studies show that 40 grams can still cause a greater increase than 20 grams. Either way, it's a good strategy to make your post-workout meal your largest meal of the day. The second time is pre-sleep, which we just talked about. 30 to 40 grams of casein protein 30 minutes before you go to sleep, and you'll be good. Now, when it comes to protein powder, you can technically eat it for any of your protein feedings. Heck, you could eat it for all of your protein intake, but we wouldn't recommend that. You still want to get most of your protein from real food sources. This is to ensure the intake of other nutrients such as vitamins and minerals, as well as other compounds such as creatine, which comes from the meat. Don't fall into the trap of thinking the protein in powder is in any way superior to that in whole foods. It's literally the same thing. Again, we recommend post-workout and pre-sleep, perhaps as a snack or part of a breakfast smoothie, and you're good to go. And most importantly of all, remember that protein powder is a supplement. Just like all other supplements, it should supplement your diet. It shouldn't be 80% of your focus. Rather, the majority of your focus should be on eating whole foods and hitting your calories and macros. If you do that, 95% of the work is done. Then your focus on supplements, such as how to use protein powder, could give you the little bump in your performance you're looking for.